We have some flyers in the back that you can take on your way out in terms of lots of, we have offer about 25 courses a year that count for your studies, and we have a minor in that that you can take a look at, and we also have great study abroad opportunities, including to Israel. That are the cheapest of the 150 study abroads in MSU, because we have $8,000 scholarships that cover the entire program fee, and then you have $500 left over to go. And so if you ever want to talk to me about either of those things, you can talk to me after the lecture is over. So without further ado, it's wonderful to invite Professor Stephen Bowman back to Michigan State University for the third time. So he's spoken here twice, and he was so interesting and knowledgeable that we've invited him once again. He's very much known for his research on Greek and Jewish relations for the past 3,000 years, and is going to be writing a book on that subject that covers the 3,000, 3,500 years. And this lecture is part of that, and he emphasizes the Byzantine and Holocaust periods. He's a professor emeritus of genetic studies at the University of Cincinnati, where he taught a range of courses on ancient and medieval Judaic studies, and he's written at least three books already, The Holocaust in Salonika, Eyewitness Account, The Agony of Greek Jews, 1940-1945, and Jewish Resistance During World War II. And for the lecture this evening, he's going to be discussing the Sepher Yosippon, which is an important work, The Origins of Sephardi, Ashkenazi, and the Romaniots. That is going to be the subject of his talk. And apparently, I did not know this before getting your description, that it's popular among Muslims, Jews, and Christians as an important work in all three religions. And we really look forward to your talk and to learning from it this evening. And please stay after and ask lots of questions, and we'll have time for discussion. Thank you so much for coming. And return.
It's absolutely wonderful. It looks like the audience is age has been divided by three. From last time I was here, it was the senior group that came, and it's really exciting to see young people have some interest in this particular subject. Let me start off with a basic question. How many of you are familiar with the Romaniots, the name Romaniots? Yeah, so these are the pros over here. Okay, we'll get back to them later. You're familiar with the name Ashkenaz? Good, now get some big studies people. And Sephardi? Okay, so let's go and find out where these names come from. This is the first thing, this is the first prologue of what we're going to do. And we'll start with the Ashkenaz, which is the least important. We're going back much further than that. It turns out that it's very interesting. Ashkenaz shows up, of course, in Genesis 10 as one of the families of the big family of nations of Genesis 10. And nobody really knew who they were. And of course, Ashkenaz, since it is now the center theme of modern Jewish history, at least until it's about the book of Israel. But even then, the historians are still mainly Ashkenazi Jews, Western Jews. Now, so where does Ashkenaz come from? In other words, it always bothered where these names come from. What do they mean? And Ashkenaz is very, very interesting. What would be the root of that for those of you who read? Because Hebrew, as you know, is a root-based language, three-letter root. And it's a very, very interesting element because it has a Greek doppelganger in Skiniazo, which means to dwell in a tent. So the theme of the word is tent dwelling. So we have the Hebrew and the Greek. So where did the Hebrew and the Greek come from? Some Hebrew words influence the Greek, some Greek words influence the Hebrew, and both of them have a common antecedent. And if we look to the Assyrian, we have the verb asakunu, same as kegel, which refers to dwell in a tent. So in effect, what these people were identified as by the Assyrian merchants who came from Mesopotamia to Western Anatolia on the major roads, is they identified the nomads in the north in the steppes of southern Russia. These nomads were called tent dwellers. We know that they traveled all the way across this 8,000 miles from China to Hungary on this flat plain and in any event, so these are the tent dwellers. And these were called by Herodotus the Scythians, which is how we usually use museums. Love the way that these people made beautiful ornaments that they brought from the cities that they attacked. All right. So anyway, so these, that's weird. Now, what's interesting about Ashkenaz is, since it's in the Bible, and nobody really knew what the hell it meant, sometime in the 4th century, the Christian historians began to identify these great migrations that were moving out of the steppes into the West and settling in Germany and calling them Ashkenazi. The Jews started moving into Ashkenaz already with the Romans. Have them in the Theodosian Corpus and living in Köln or Cologne in the 4th century. But the main development of Ashkenaz as a Jewish place begins in the 10th century. Already we have stories in Charlemagne's time, and those might have been Sephardi from Spain who came up to live in France, but it was the Jews from southern Italy, namely Greek-speaking Jews, who moved northward in Italy and then crossed into the land of Ashkenaz and gradually took upon themselves the identity of Ashkenazim, people who lived in Ashkenaz. All right, we'll leave them. They don't become important for another few hundred years. Sfarad, where does that come from? That really interested me for a long time until poking through the web one day. Came across the grammar of Luvian. Luvian is a southwest Anatolian language representing a kingdom that existed there in the first millennium. And so you look through it, of course, what do you find? Something to look at, curiosity, didn't kill the cat, entertain the scholar. So what happens? I come across a bilingual inscription. Grave inscription. And in this grave inscription, they identified a place where this poor person was buried, a rich person was buried, I should say, that's spelled S digamma R D. The digamma is pronounced as S. So it turns out that this is the, and in the Aramaic translation, it was spelled Sfarad. So, no problem. So the question is, where is this Sfarad? So it turns out that this refers to Sardis, which has the same consonants as Sfarad. And Sardis, of course, was a major Jewish center. Now, what's fun is how the modern scholars had no idea where Sfarad was located. So we have people identifying Sarepta in Lebanon. Why? Because the prophet says in far off Sfarad. Of course, Lebanon must be far off from Israel. But anyway, so let's skip that particular episode. That was an old story. So what does it mean? Southwest Anatolia is far off from Israel. And the Jews identified themselves as living in Sfarad. Merchants, then, even further, when they went to Spain, they took that identity with them and gave that to the country. So that's where Sepharad comes from. And now we know that probably by way of Carthage. And it's much easier to follow ourselves from him than Carthaginians. We have enough problem with him as well. And anyway, it says it's a great hero, the Carthaginian Hannibal, and he sort of didn't really make it in American hero. Romaniot comes from Rome. And the Roman Empire, as you know, spread from England all the way to Arabia. And the Greeks identify themselves as Romaioi. And the Jews call themselves Romans, since they had the citizens of the Roman Empire called the free Jewish, and most of them were free by that time, as Romans themselves. As they said, instead of Roma, they added the T to carry the Romaniote. All right, anyway, that's the prologue. So what we have is the importance then of the Greek Jews to the development of the two major branches. Now we can skip up to that section. What we find is it was a highly developed poetic tradition, synagogue poetry, amongst the Jews, who gave it to the Christians, who inherited from the Greeks, and the Christian Greeks. And the Jews developed a highly sophisticated piyut tradition. Piyut itself comes from Greek poesis. So the importance of poetry, especially in an oral life and in an oral society, allows you to remember things. Extremely important in continuing Midrashic tradition that is the creative commentary on the biblical tradition. And if you wanted to know what Solomon's court looked like, what was the throne, you would read the throne of Solomon, which was a Byzantine composition. And the Byzantines themselves, namely the Greek-speaking Roman rulers, read the Bible, took Greek mechanical genius and built Solomon's throne. Lions that roared, and all kinds of birds that chirped on the throne. And they could elevate the throne so that the emperor could sit high above people. So the Midrash then, not only the rabbinic Palestinian Midrash, classic ones that we study, but also all the minor Midrash, many of the minor Midrash were also created in Byzantium. So we have Midrash, we have poetry, we also have legal studies, halakhic studies. We also have the first historian, Jewish historian, since Josephus, that appears, and the last real Jewish historian before the 19th century German Jews started writing scientific history, playing people scientific history, and fortunately grew out of that. So we have 20th century historians who now understood the wide range of the Jewish experience and the Jewish creativity and how to write history that is more or less readable. In any event, so who is this Jewish historian? Probably the only real historian in general of the Middle Ages. Now we have lots of histories from the Middle Ages. Most of them written by churchmen. Others written, especially during the Renaissance, by former statesmen or scholars, but not real history, but they're the histories of the old times. Obviously, journalistic reports, very accurate, very good, very opinionated, but nonetheless, it is from them that scholars have been able to recreate the modern period, literally, histories per se. But the author of this book, who is unfortunately anonymous, what he did was to take the books that had survived, namely Josephus, who was the major Jewish historian for the Christian Church, almost canonized as semi-sacred by the Christian Church, simply because Jesus is mentioned twice in Josephus. Josephus wrote 18 books of his antiquities. But anyway, he was the major describer of the Jewish interaction with Rome in the ancient period, with this description of
give you the longer screen. It's just this flashing red and white, like. You've had it this way for too long. We can't do anything.
Okay, it says the system's turning up.
All right.
Sorry about that.
Right. Some of us. I can't do artificial intelligence. I can't do computers. I mean, this is not my world. All right, in any event, so what he did is Josephus was the major historian, not only for the Jews, but the recorder and interpreter of the Jewish experience of the Romans. And of course, he mentions Jesus in an interpolated or adjusted passage. The church, which was also interested in that first century because that was the first Christian century, used him as a basis really for not only writing history but also for understanding the period in which the New Testament arose. And also Josephus wrote the History of Jewish Wars, which begins with the Maccabees. And these printed or copied separately. In other words, the histories from the antiquities. And the antiquities really covers the whole biblical period, and this in effect contains pre-rabbinic commentaries, on the Rashi commentaries on the Bible. So it gives us another insight, if you will, into the priestly tradition of how to read the Bible creatively. So not only does he take Josephus's history, he also takes the books of the Maccabees. He also takes Roman sources, and his major source is a 4th century Christian anti-Jewish treatise called On the Destruction of Jerusalem by an anonymous author who is identified as Pseudo-Hegesippus. Now, Hegesippus was a 2nd century Jew who converted to Christianity and wrote a history of the church in 5 we have very few fragments that survive in Eusebius' greatest left of the history of the church. So, Yosippon, which we now call the book, Yosippon also had access to Roman histories and Greek histories available in Latin, or show us that he was in Greek. So he did most of the source material in Latin, and he read the classic Latin texts on this particular period and excerpted stories from them that he put in, broad, specifically Jewish aspects of his own history. And he also did creative things. For example, when he writes, and he eventually puts it all together, when he writes a history of the Second Temple period from the return after the destruction of the Babylonian Empire to the destruction of the Second Temple by the Romans. And in this, he has all kinds of wonderful legendary material. The legend of the sacred fire, which Jeremiah supposedly hid, so that in the event that the Jews would get back to Jerusalem, they would be able to rebuild the temple, find the sacred fire, so they could relight the altar and make sacrifices. Which is kind of fun. And he also writes the history of Esther from the Book of Esther, but he does a strange thing because he puts prayers in her mouth. She prayed, she fasted, she prayed. So Where did he get the phrase? Did he make it up out of whole cloth? No. He found a Midrashic text in which we have the prayer of Joseph and the Egyptian wife,
Asnat.
Right. So the prayer of Asnat, he translates that into Hebrew. So this is his expansion, if you will, of the text. In the ancient world, they didn't write scientific history. They expanded things that they needed to expand things. And it's interesting to compare the original source from which he read to the way in which he expanded. And there was some absolutely lovely things in there. For example, the rabbinic legend of tradition that Rome was descended from Esau, brother of Joseph, brother of Jacob, that the two quarreled, and eventually Esau became the enemy of the true Jews, as opposed to the over the track people. Why in the end? So he takes the grandson of Esau and makes him into a Roman hero, a great warrior who succeeds in eventually going by Egypt and then Carthage. He makes one of the Tito, he is dead. And he then goes to Rome, where something strange is happening to the people there. This terrible creature, this eating cat. I think it's called Cato. And so what does he do? He has his grandson of Esau kill this creature, and becoming the king of the Romans, and a god who's birthday is a major festival in his name, thus creating a tradition that Rome actually is the symbol of Esau, and therefore Edo, and that's how you justify the tradition. Where we got the story, we don't know. How he developed that story, we don't know. But there were probably some 50,000 Jews in Rome in the first century. Had to have all kinds of things. Right. Plus, plenty of Jewish prisoners of war who came with their old knowledge. Professor Feldman actually wrote an article arguing that the Jewish prisoners of war actually built the Colosseum in Rome. All right, so what else does Yosippon do? Yosippon has a beautiful Hebrew style. In fact, it was taught at the Hebrew University as a model of Hebrew style. In addition to being, you know, a good and entertaining history, until we get, of course, to the destruction of Jerusalem in the end of the first century, and that then becomes the traditional reading for Tisha B'Av, which is the annual of the destruction of both temples. So it's usually in the various synagogues, and in the Rothschild manuscript of Yosippon, it actually is in the column. Yosippon is in the column of it as the commentary of Yosippon, there's a commentary rather to the special poems that are chanted on Tisha B'Av. So, and Shai Agnon, who was the Israeli Nobel Prize winner back in the mid-60s, in one of his novels, says that on the Sabbath, when you do your Jewish on the Sabbath, relax to understand the ways of animals by reading the Midrash, the Fox Fables.
nature.
And he's right, because you have a tremendous psychological and social insights and political insights into human interaction that he provides to Josephus and to others. Absolutely wonderful read, and I highly recommend it to you
as such, even including the Maccabees period. In any event, what we have then is Jews in Byzantium flourishing from the rise of Christianity in the East, when the Romans turned the Eastern Balkans into not only part of the Roman Empire, but in fact the center of the East. Major branch of the empire, we begin to see problems for the Jews. Christianity in its fight against paganism also fought against Judaism. And this becomes a central theme, if you will, in Christian history that persists really until the period, namely the challenge, if you will, between these two monotheistic texts. Which is the true continuator of God's message, of God's will, as such. So what did the Christians do? First of all, they had to get rid of the pagans. And by a series of laws, they basically outlawed pagans, in other words, the polytheism of the nature religions practiced throughout the Roman Empire. And one of the ways in which they did it was very clever. They stopped paying the salaries of all of the pagan priests. And what happens when people pay the salary of priests? They go into something else. Many of them, or many of the pagan intellectuals, became Christians. That way they were upper echelons of lawyers, philosophers, religious people. And since the temples were closing, and the ones that weren't closed were taken over by monks who rose in the 4th century also, that it just wasn't the thing to be. So they either went underground or they converted and changed Christianity to include the pagan things that they wanted to keep. And also, I would suggest that a good percentage of Jews also, because of the economic and political and social pressures against them, they also converted to Judaism. I have got to go from Judaism to Christianity. And that also continues. In the Cincinnati area, you'll find a Jewish catalog. This is an absolute historical fact. So, in effect, it, for social reasons, then people were depressed. So, this was one of the same as the Jews did in the first century. So after the legal persecutions under Justinian and later, I rather under Theodosius and then later under Justinian. law codes, the situation of the Jews, if you will, declined, even though they continued to speak Greek and Hebrew, although they made the mistake of picking up some of the exiles from after the Roman Empire recognized the end of the Patriarchate in the early 5th century. That Patriarchate was in the tradition, or rather in the lineage of Hillel, Babylonian Jew, whom the rabbis claimed. Calendar and the education of Jewish officials pretty much were the spokesman for Jews for three centuries in the late antique period. But in the 20s, Count Leo II died without being heir, and 3 years later, it was 429, the emperor recognized that there was no heir to the throne of Hillel, and thus the whole institution of patriarchate sort of disappeared. Thus sending out all of these scholars, these graduate students, these professionals, these administrators, these teachers, out into the Jewish diaspora, especially Greek-speaking diaspora. Gets a little hairy. Justinian was the first to really stick his nose into how Judaism was defined itself and how it lived. His code, of course, put all sorts of restrictions on them. His Christianization of Roman law. He did away with the death penalty, which was God punished him for restructuring the second degree. In any event, he forcibly converted to Judaism, to Christianity, a semi-independent island in the Red Sea. And that was the beginning, if you will, of 4 centuries of Byzantine persecution of the Jews. Of forcibly baptizing Jews into Christianity was a kind of nationalistic attempt to make everybody one emperor, one empire, one religion. You heard that in Germany had the Roman tradition, but it wasn't the Roman tradition. This already happened during the Maccabean period. Antiochus attempted to convert all the Jews to his worship of the Greek religion. And I have a suspicion that it was on that basis, which is right in the Book of Maccabees, that they were able to find, and he found it. Emperors had a tremendous problem. When Islam conquered the southern Mediterranean, the east Mediterranean, the southern Mediterranean, they lost over half of the empire. And when the Slavs came pouring into the Balkans in the next century, the 8th, 7th century, this threatened to swamp Greek civilization, or the Greek-speaking civilization of Empire.
So the idea is, how do you preserve the Greekness of the Roman Empire? By converting the Jews. And also by converting the Slavs. And by fighting the Arabs, which of course is the Celtic. So we know that they sent out merchants to trade with them. They sent out merchants as ambassadors. They sent out monks, priests as ambassadors. They would come back on these. Or they didn't come back. Because these guys were absolute fanatics, these missionaries. They would challenge the local god by putting their hand. Not showing any pain. Really. But then Byzantine Christianity, modern Christianity, Orthodox Christianity, is extremely mystical and what we decide. There's all sorts of situations. At least they do now. But we have these stories, or some of these stories are mythical. But in any event, they were able to impress the so-called Bavarians. You know the word Bavarian comes from, by the way. So they called them barbarians, and everybody was a barbarian. Even the Armenians were barbarians. But they were Christians. It wasn't just Armenian Christians. And they were heretics. So heretics of all sorts. Byzantium was full of heresies, all kinds of heresies. Every bishop would become a heretic if he disagreed with the Orthodox majority. So they were persecuted in various ways, but entitled to live as Roman citizens. They were under third-class citizens, but they all survived in various ways. And Byzantium never massacred the Jews. Put tremendous pressures on it, but it never massacred. There was never a massacre by Greeks since that period of Jews historically. Massacres. Pressures, yes. Religious pressures, economic pressures, social pressures, legal pressures, but no massacres. It's interesting. Totally different from the West. In any event, there's great tradition of Byzantine Jewish culture with its poetry and with its other accomplishments, mainly its mastery of Greek. In the second and later period of the last three centuries, they actually became, along with the Venetians, helpmates to the Byzantine emperor, namely because they were merchants and they were trustworthy against the Genoese and against the other Western powers that were beginning to make inroads into Byzantine society. Now, during this period, a recent book which treats of seven major intellectual figures, and we know that the Paleologue period, the last few centuries, named that Paleologue House, produced a number of men of letters whose treatises and all sorts of sciences and philosophy have survived. And is grist for, should be grist for all classical graduate students who are looking for theses. Some years ago, we have hundreds of manuscripts that were unedited and such. And this would be a really good contribution to the classics of modern is to do that. Connected means and writing a whole dissertation on it. But unfortunately, we have good stuff that's being found back to our classical library. In any event, these seven figures are major intellectual figures, who are both Kabbalists and philosophers. And we can see that both in terms of the
continuing poetic contributions, their philosophic contributions, their translations of the originals of Greek philosophers for the for Western Jews who knew Greek and had to read their Greek philosophers in Arabic translation. Syrian Christians in the 8th century and translated most of the Greek heritage and then Jews translated that into Arabic, and then from Arabic they translated into Hebrew, and thus this whole Greek intellectual tradition moved to the Western world. But what's really fun about it, it still continued in Greece, in Greek, creatively. Now, Greece, of course, became an independent nation, and the first of the independent nations after the French Revolution. The French Revolution, I should remind you, was stimulated by the American Revolution. So the French tend to forget because we can speak French, instead of French. So Greece becomes after a bloody revolution against the Turks. By the way, this was the one massacre of the Jews that existed. The Jews were living within the Turkish compounds in various cities where they rose against the Turks and killed the Turks. They also killed all the Jews, especially in the south. But immediately, Jews flocked to Athens, resurrected their Greek, went to Greek universities, became Greek lawyers, became Greek politicians, intellectuals, and became fully Greek, albeit Jewish, but fully Greek. And the Jews of the north, of course, were affected by the rise of nationalism among the Greeks. And we even have a poem by this Alexander Hobson, who's a great poetic translator. Now, the Jews of Salonika were divided about how to deal with this problem. Before the war, they said, well, we have three options. We can stay with Turkey, we can go with Greece, or we can get an independent port at Danzig. So these three different groups, or we can go to Palestine. And this group, Yeshu, that's developed here. And many of them did go. So you've got four options, if you will. Smartphones, of course, came to the United States. You have Greek Jewish colonies scattered around the United States. But the bulk of them stayed in that area. Because they left Salonika, lived for 2,000 years, or 500 years, and had produced their own great civilization, and sort of knew the neighborhood. And they produced newspapers, and multilingual newspapers, four language newspapers, Bulgarian, Greek, Hebrew, and Judeo Spanish. So in wooing them, Athens decided to give them a 10-year lease on service in the army, and even longer if they were cantors, in other words, religious rabbis. So we find lots of people studying in many different religious schools and colleges in the Jewish community. They went to the army, or didn't go to the army, and didn't become soldiers. Although in the First Balkan War, we find that there were dozens of Jews who fought and were recognized by the state for heroic action during the First Balkan. And later, by the 1920s, we have professional soldiers, Greek soldiers, out of the Jewish community. But it all sort of hit the fan in the 30s. With the rise of strong Greek nationalism, who, of course, didn't recognize the Jews, Greeks and Jews who are very arrogant, each of them. Deal with the animosity of the others. And even though the Greeks recognized the Balfour Declaration and supported the Jews who went to Israel, nonetheless, up in the north, the influence of Mussolini and his fascism affected the poor Greeks and the intellectual Greeks. The two Greeks and thinkers, they were the basis of anti-Jewish traditions already since. And the Black Sea Greeks, who came flooding into Athens from the great Greek communities that had developed around the Black Sea, from Crimea to Odessa, Odessa in particular. So they started coming and, of course, brought their animosities against the Jews to Greece itself, which then developed as these poor peasants became educated in how to survive in a modern world. So first, Italian fascism came in, especially in the cities, because that's an urban ideology. And then later, Nazism, again, picked up by since it was really an intellectual approach to compensate for the Marxist approach, which was coming from as well. All of this was totally upsetting the traditional stability of Greek society. And then the danger, if you will, of international communism, especially in the 1930s, led to a resurgent Heraclean ideology of
which protected the Jews, because the Jews were citizens. But at the same time, it also crushed, for a while, the communist movement in Greece. And in its attempt to curry favor with Germany, since Germany then was rich into Greece, and was doing all kinds of creative things, like buying Greek foodstuffs cheap and selling them to German mechanical things, arms, machines, things of that nature, expensive, that the Greek government came to put them close to bankruptcy, and not even the money that the British kept lending Greece had since the 1830s. So you had Germany versus Britain in Greece in terms of the overall political situation, alongside the movement of communism and fascism and Nazism fighting with each other. So it was a very complicated place. Now, so the Metaxas government, in suspending the constitution, also threw out all of the army officers who had been trained in France, because he himself was a graduate of the German military school. And so he fostered all of the German trained Greek officers, many of whom betrayed the country during the German invasion of Greece. For example, the eve of the German invasion of Greece, the Germany had to invade Greece. Mussolini had invaded Greece in 1940 and got his ass kicked, which I think is the latest book to remember that standard phrase that was used. Three generals of three invasions were defeated, and Mussolini himself took the fourth one, and he was even pushed. So he called on help, and bingo, they invaded the Balkans, sliced their way through Yugoslavia, which was chaos, and very quickly conquered Salonika in April, and Athens a few months later in Crete, which is one of the great battles of World War II, which was the first parachute invasion, the last real parachute invasion of the war. Most of us paratroopers to British over there, mainly the Cretans over there, and especially the Cretan women, which is a kind of thing. In fact, so much so that when 25 Cretan women were captured by the Germans, they were sent to Athens, to prison, concentration camp, and they were allowed to keep their knives. So that'll give you an idea later. So don't be afraid of the military machine gun. The Russians taught us. In any event, so Germany now controlled all of Greece. It kept a small part for itself, maybe Salonika, about the Crete, the border. Turkey to separate the Bulgarians from the Turks. It gave Thrace and Macedonia to Bulgaria, and the rest of Greece and its islands to the Italians, because Mussolini wanted to increase the Roman Empire to the Roman peasants. He trained divisions. Anyway, the Holocaust of the Greek Jews really begins in January of 1943.
already in July of 1942, with the Black Sabbath, some 13,000 Salonika Jewish men and Sephardi Jewish men to recall Germany was collecting slaves from all over the conquered area and place that they conquered and used them, if you will, to replace the fact that they had so many millions of men in the army. They needed workers. And they wouldn't let women work because they were so many babies. So they brought these slave workers in from all these different countries to do so. And of course they wanted to degrade the Jews. And then they started shipping these young men out to repair the damage that had taken place when the British were through from Greece, making them blow up destroying railroads, destroying bridges, some of those rebuilding stuff. So they took the Jews that they put into forced labor and sent them down. It was the same thing they did elsewhere. Other countries, but in fact, Greek has an insalubrious climate, and these guys were dying of flies. So the mothers and daughters of these men went and complained to the Jewish community, do so, bring them back before they're all dead. So they put so much pressure on them that negotiations began to get them back. The Germans said, all right, give us 3 billion dollars worth of 3 billion dollars, $250,000. And they, the Jewish community finally sold or gave the Great Jewish Cemetery with a half a million graves in it in return for a lower in price and for bringing back many of these men from the forced labor. In January, Eichmann sent two of his lieutenants to Sepharda, and they introduced the new rules, which effectively put the Jews outside of the Greek civil society. And in March of 1943, the deportations began. 2,000 entered into the camp of Auschwitz. The rest were killed and arrived. In the meantime, Jews who had been in the army, as Greek Orthodox who had been in the army, as communists who had been in the army, refused to surrender when the Germans surrounded them. So they went off into the mountains. In fact, the classic Greek cry of resistance was stolen up to the mountains, onto the hills, as they say in Kentucky. And they went up in the hills, and they sabotaged against the Germans, sabotaged against the Italians, sabotaged against the Bulgarians. Well, it wasn't well received by the Ottomans. The Italians were women and children into the churches and burned to the ground. So much for the life of Italians. Italians, however, when they were captured by the resistance later on, were not allowed to fight, even though they surrendered all their weapons to the resistance, but they made great cooks. So they could increase the culinary expertise of the resistance. The Bulgarians were even more vicious because they hated the Greeks. Answer the problem of resistance in the north, they butchered some 15,000 people in the city of Cyrus, also a city outside of Salonika, and driving some 40,000 Greek peasants governor general of Salonica didn't like Jews anymore. Said, gee, I don't mind that the Jews are going to be controlled by the Germans to live in these wonderful new communities that are built in Poland. And then we'll have all the houses for 40,000 refugees. So that worked out well for the Greeks, although they haven't been guilty. Stones from the graveyard were then taken away by Greek contractors and used for building projects. Rebuild the streets that the Germans had paved with Jewish gravestones. Took down the pools that the Germans had built down with Jewish gravestones. And repaired the churches in the Italian temple. I think the resistance story at this point is actually time. The resistance. This book, which was put out by the Jewish Museum of Greece. This is fellow fighters, fellow comrades, fellow fighters. And this lists about 650 to 700 the names of all those who were identified in the resistance and individual stories as such. You can get a copy by writing to the Jewish Museum of Greece in Athens. And I think it's also online, most of this, as well, if you look at the Jewish Museum of Athens website. Lots of resistance heroes. In fact, they had a book some years ago that outlined the Jews in resistance. I found it fascinating. During the war, one of the two national heroes that the Greek government recognized was a peasant from the Peloponnese. One of the Hyphrises was raised posthumously to be a colonel who led the Greek forces to drive back the Italian invasion of Western Greece. And then he was killed. And his niece. I got a chapter on his niece, absolutely fascinating. Sarika, she was called, which is the diminutive Sarah. At the age of 15, this precocious girl took her mother up into the mountain. She said to her friends when she was when they were doing the occupation, that she really didn't want to stay there anymore under the occupation because they would be forced to house this. Dentist. This lady was just sitting by the window with a rifle and fake shooting people in the street. I don't know what he wore. So she said to her friend, we want to go up to the mountains. He says, good, we'll have somebody to cook and clean for us. He says, no, I don't cook and clean. It's a real calamity, James. I don't want to cook and clean. She goes up into the mountains. And she's 15 years old, 16 years old at this point. And poor mother was riding a mule up the mountains, a donkey up the mountains, or something. And Sarika becomes an expert shot. She could put out the core of an apple in 100 yards. So I'm very famous. Greek American journalist. Or a story something else. In any event, she put together a group of young girls her age, 15, 16, and late and set up grenades. And the battalions would come running to find the synoptical leads. And while they were there, the main resistance forces would be in the other place, blowing up the bridges. So she gradually became quite famous, if you will. And she was famous for her group of girls. I promised her mother that she would watch out for them. She would go down into the villages and beg for some young men to come up and fight on the hills with her. so she became known as the teacher. And she had a cousin, also was up in the hills, who was a teacher. So a collaborator told the journalist that he found the teacher. So they sent a unit up to they tortured her to death in public. They killed her. And Sarika, while she was walking up in the hills, came across this guy and was walking to a truck. And when she got caught, she lifted up her skirt, took out a pistol, shot in the head. So she was a tough lady. Okay, I think we've got that. And probably the one good thing that happened after the war, when 87% of the Jews were dead, only 2,000 came back, 60,000. And most of those eventually went to Israel. Socialist government, passed the law, which returned to the first country that did so, and returned to the Jews all the property that had been confiscated, which meant that the community has tremendous resources, which is now in deep trouble because they're mostly in housing, and Greece is in such an economic mess that nobody can afford to pay the rent. So, budget. which they had previously supported all of the small communities in the Balkans and contributed money to the Jews in Ukraine, as well as Israel, has dried up completely. So that's one of the sad things. That's kind of an economic disaster. In any event, let me bring this to close and see if we can take a few questions. Eliphaz is his name. No, he's the son of Eliphaz. I keep forgetting his first name. That's his name. So, Eliphaz. Eliphaz is the son of Esau. But yeah, fascinating. In fact, the author of Yosippon takes the story of Heracles, who kills the mountain goat, kills a monster, and this is the monster. And he has him as the one who's devouring stealing cattle and he kills every fox. This is what makes him go out for. But he has such poignant stories. Josephus tells us a story of a terrible famine. Anyway, the rebel leaders smell the roasting flesh and come to the house and say, "How can you dare eat when the whole house and the whole city is starving to death?" And she says, "No. Don't say that this is wrong, that this is not my child. This is my child. I killed him, I cooked him, I ate him, but I saved half of him for you." And she probably was mad. Chastises them for not being able to share in the meal that she was feast that she prepared. The best part of the note is we found out where Josephus got his story from. It's a story from Elijah, and in it is the story of the woman who made a bargain with another woman that they would eat each other's children. So they killed the other woman's child, the two of them ate it, and then she refused to kill her child. And this, of course, became a scandal in that particular story.
So while we're waiting for your translation to come out, what's the best way to read Yosippon in English?
Well, the Maccabean part of that was translated by Gaston, at the end of the 19th century. This is just after Hex discovered this huge manuscript of century Midrashim that were published by the Jewish scholars of the Covenant, Jewish manuscript. So he found the story of Yosephus, which everybody forgot, and he translated.
Is legitimate. After all, Midrash comes from Drash, and Drash is what Solomon talked to God with. A demand, a question. people come up with these theories of absolutely off the wall. Nothing. David Flusser, who's the great philologist, historian of the Second Temple period in Israel, and the major Dead Sea Scrolls scholar who knew all of the manuscripts, all of them, before he was hired at the university. Geshem Shalom, the founder of Jewish mysticism, said to Flusser, who had been educated by the Jesuits, and was actually fluent in Greek and Latin, was a master of all of Christian literature.
in any event, he thinks that he went to the library in Naples, which had several copies of Josephus, and he might have worked in that library. I wonder that. How did Jews get into monasteries? Scholars could get into monasteries all the generations. That wasn't the problem. So he thinks Naples.
Maybe.
Or there was a great yeshiva in the barrio with a large line. Because we found that the Jewish kids were learning Hebrew by translating Greek into Hebrew. Greek school. For example, the famous life of Alexander. And they were translating it to Hebrew. And we know that they were translating it into Hebrew to learn because we have the Arabic translations of the Romance of Alexander in France. That they actually said they used three different terms for what they were doing. They were copying, they were translating. So this is how the kids were learning languages, especially when they're telling study culture.